This is Akiyomoto, and in this episode we are discussing the four types of Roman theaters, which we can find all in one city. Let's go! We are here in the Roman province of Gallia, Lugdunum. And we are not only in the province, but in the capital of this province. The capital which gave the province its name, Lugdunum. The Roman city of Lugdunum, the modern city of Lyon. We are walking here on this Roman monumental street in the middle of the old city center, which is located on the central mountain of Fourvière. And what I would like to discuss in this episode with you are the four types of Roman theaters, because this city actually has all of them. And we will discuss a bit the differences of these theaters and for what purpose they were built and used. So let's get up to the first theater. So I'm walking again on this nicely paved Roman road. On our left there are parts of the city center used by different houses. And these houses were partially on this side so-called taverne. So, places where you could buy food, for instance. This place could be one of these taverne. So you would enter here, they had their food there, and you could just choose the meal of the day or something. And this was a really good spot for such a place, because we are just above the Roman theater of Lugdunum. And the style of the theater is just a theater, a Roman theater, which means in Roman times it's half circular. You have already seen one. And then the seating rows are going up from there, leaning to the hill, but also supported by some substitutes down there. So let's go down a bit. So this theater is actually one of the oldest ones, because it has a first construction phase in the 1st century BC. And the first year that was going up until here, to this seating row, had only some 80 meters or so in diameter. But then the second construction phase was opened to the entire public and therefore enlarged by a big amount to 108 diameters, so it could house 10,000 people in here. Down there you see the orchestra, then the wooden stage, and then this few remainings of columns there. That's the so-called Scene France, which was like just the background of the stage, actually. We will go down there soon. But first I want to discuss what they actually played here. So this was a real theater. They had two main genres showing here. And the first one is the comedy. The comedy you could subscribe with something like Sex and Crime. So it was funny, it was ridiculous and obscene in certain ways. So people were sitting here chattering while the actors were overacting fully. They were wearing ridiculous masks and telling stories about cheating, love, murderer and stuff like this. The second genre is the tragedy. And the tragedy is comparable with the modern opera, let's say. There were sometimes old Greek pieces, so already some centuries ago, like the opera today. And they were like telling severe stories of life, of love, and stuff like this. This is quite interesting because this tragedy, sometimes it was really hard to look at, much more than the comedy. And this is why the Romans especially tried to make it more interesting through playing with the requisitories. So what they did were like trying to reconstruct ship battles in here and other kind of things. And to do so they had an actual wooden construction underneath the orchestra stage, which was helping with weights and ropes to bring up some stuff, ships or whatever, or actors even, and to make things appear on stage. It's really interesting. So this theater was housing 10,000 people, I already told you. So let's go down, because as of today, the most expensive ticket are the ones down there and most closely to the actual stage. The actors that were playing were most often slaves or people who got their freedoms but were slaves before. So they were actually very low in the social hierarchy. Quite the contrary of the people sitting here next to the stage. They were here, had here a separated area where they could see, which was covered by nice marble stones here. Really fantastic. And often they had even reservated seats. So sometimes you find stones where the names of the people were engraved into it. And now I'm entering the orchestra, the central space of this theater. As you can see, it's also nicely made of stone slabs, colored stone slabs, and they made this really nice pavement. And here all the singing and acting took place, and dancing, of course, was all here. And then there was this wooden stage, which was also part of the entering. So I will just try to climb up here. And from this wooden stage we can actually see how the seating rows are building up in front of us over several stories. It made quite an impression, and it has also an acoustic purpose. So the people sitting up there, they can probably hear me right now. So, and just behind this wooden stage, we have the Scene France, which is like rising up two or three stories from here, all columned, and with these absidial structures here. These absidial structures were often housing statues of the actual emperor or of the gods. It was just the background of the actual theater place. It was really nice. Here everything is columned. And if we enter behind the Skene, there's actually some structures here where we can see some remainings. Where the actors here could actually change, hidden from the public, but here they would change and then enter the stage. Yeah. Now I want to show you this one last thing, because I told you already that sometimes they even played like ship battles here. So what they needed was of course water, and how to get water in here to give the impression to be on the open sea. So they built here some channels where they could easily bring the water from the city into the theater if needed. Yeah, that's it from the first theater. That's the, yeah, let's say the normal theater we all know, also today. So let's just walk to the second one, which is just next to this theater. Yeah, just a quick note, this is quite interesting because here we have a big stone slab just on the entrance of this theater, and you see these marks in the stone which are now filled of water, but they were used to house the actual door, so it would slide open like this over this round holes here. Entering the Odeon, look at these nice marble slabs here. They were used to cover the usual stone wall with this not very thick marble slabs, but it's like really nice to look at, and it gave the impression that the entire thing was made out of marble. Nice. So I'm entering the second theater now, and we are entering now from below, directly on the orchestra. And as you can see, this orchestra is even more finer, elaborated with different colored stones put together to form some sort of a mosaic here with certain mathematical forms here. What we can also see right here, again, the seats for the VIPs, the most closest seats to the orchestra. And here they were even blocked from the usual public by this stone made fence, which is elaborated with this astragal type of decoration, which is usually which you can usually find in wooden fences. Yeah, this theater here is much smaller. It has only, I think, 60 meters in diameter, and was only housing like 1,000 or 2,000 people. And this theater was actually used for a different purpose. This was an Odeon. So here would happen more like musical performances and also poetical performances, and sometimes even religious rituals or political proclamations. So it had a really different purpose and it's maybe comparable with the modern Philharmonica or something. So really nice. This was Theater 2. And now I'm gonna have a seat. And we're going to the Amphitheater of Lyon. Oh, it's nice here on the VIP seat. Now we are heading to the Amphitheater, which is on the outskirts of the city, down from the central hill. And this amphitheater is really interesting because it is built together with the sanctuary of the Three Gauls. So this needs a small explanation also about the history of Lugdunum, because Lugdunum, as the province capital, was not only the capital of, only of the province, but also the meeting point for all responsibles from the three provinces which were made up, which made the Gaul. There is Gallia Lugdunum, where we are right now. There is Gallia Belgica in the north, and there is Gallia Aquitania in the south. And they were meeting here on several occasions at the sanctuary of the Three Gauls, just down there at the amphitheater. And there they built already in the first century a small theater which was just used by the people and representatives of these Three Gauls. But then again, this was enlarged heavily, so it could house 20,000 people. And this is almost the estimated number of the entire population of Lugdunum. So they built a theater to house almost all the population of the city, which is quite interesting. And in the amphitheater, which was from a structure entirely round, so the seating rows were going in a circle around the central stage, unlike those three theaters I just showed you before, which are semicircular. And there they were having severe gladiator fights, or fights with animals. So just from a cultural perspective, it is much lower, more or less comparable maybe with modern soccer or something in comparison to the opera here. But nonetheless very popular, of course. And that was the third theater here in Lugdunum. Yeah, and the fourth theater here at Lugdunum is actually a false one, because we just know that there used to be a hippodrome here in Lugdunum by ancient inscriptions, coins, and some pottery stamps, but archaeologists haven't found it yet. So this is still one target here to do in Lugdunum, finding the hippodrome. The hippodrome was an oval structure, a long structure, which was used for horse and chariot racing. Also very popular around that time. And they were just chasing around three or wooden or stone pillars on each side, and they were just racing around it. Yeah, that's it. So we have seen four different types of theaters here at Lugdunum. And next stop, I don't really know yet, but we are heading south to the Mediterranean now. Okay, see you next time. Bye.